We are very lucky to be the first cohort to live on this planet, which can molecularly manipulate our bodies such that within 30 years, average human life expectancy will rise from the mid-80s in the developed world to 110 or 120. At the moment, medical science is principally concerned with treating the key diseases of aging rather than treating aging itself as a disease. But science is making a big advance in terms of treating those diseases of aging, and in particular, the five key ones. Those key ones take 70% of the people who die on this planet away. That's 160,000 people a day who die, and 70% of them die of either cardiovascular disease, cancer, respiratory disease, Alzheimer's, stroke, dementia, or obesity, stroke, diabetes. And there's been remarkable improvements in the outcomes for patients suffering from most of those diseases. So, for instance, cardiovascular disease is falling in the developed world by 2 to 4% per annum. And cancer, as a result of the development of new immunotherapies in the past 5 years, will become a chronic or curable condition within the next decade or so. So many of these diseases of aging are being conquered, and that will contribute to the longevity that my colleagues and I are forecasting for the next 3 decades. The first person to live to over 150 is almost certainly amongst us. That will be the result of such techniques as gene editing, following on from the discovery of CRISPR-Cas9 as recently as 2012, the evolution of stem cells as a therapy, which is now coming into its own, the use of pigs as an example to create organs which that can then be retransplanted into human beings, and whole tissue regeneration. Artificial intelligence, which has come to the fore in the past few years, having been around since the 1950s, will play a very important part in this armamentarium of longevity. First of all, artificial intelligence is already being used to generate new compounds which are unique and much faster to develop than those that by the traditional methods that the pharmaceutical industry uses. And the second, of course, is in the diagnosis of disease at a much earlier and with a much greater efficacy than we currently have. And both of those are marching forward at a very rapid pace, such that, for instance, cancers can now be detected 4 years earlier than by using conventional methods such as CT spiral scans or MRIs or even X-rays. And the result of that is that cancers, as an example, can be treated at a very early stage with a much, much more positive outcome for the patient. At the moment, we expect to be born, to learn, to earn, sometimes to burn out, to retire, and then to expire. That is going to change because we're going to be adding something like 40% to general life expectancy in the developed world. At the same time as human longevity is expanding, the fertility rate of women in the developed world has been collapsing. The result of that is that the world is going to be much more age-heavy, if we can put it that way. But of course, the older people will be much more robust than they are currently. They won't be characterized by a frail condition. They will be welderly rather than elderly. And the effect of that is that they are going to consume things that they like to consume, unlike what the younger population consumes, and that consumption pattern will alter the economics of many societies. The industries that will be totally disrupted by this include the financial services industry, where life insurance companies, their models will be completely upended, where pension plans will be inadequate and will possibly even go bankrupt. Almost everything in the financial industry will be completely changed as a result of this. So we certainly inhabit a planet where people are going to live much longer than anyone has before, and this will have tremendous consequences for almost every facet of our lives.